policing here in Evanston citywide, and not just in my scenario. And in my specific case, yes, there was some. One of the officers was. So I was arrested while petitioning to get on the ballot. If anyone doesn't know about it, while running for office here in Evanston, and so one of the officers retired before the investigation was concluded, the sergeant. And then the other officer, Officer Galupski, received suspension, and she is now fighting the suspension. But what I really want to see done here
is that a paid suspension, by the way. I'm just saying.
So both of the officers received administrative leave for about a month, okay. And now this is an unpaid suspension, but she is battling that.
Sure, and the reason I bring that up is, you know, that's for the future, that's pretty important as a mayor to make sure that police and community actually have good relationships.
Yes.
I've, you know, been on the Citizens Police Academy, and I would ask any civilian or citizen, thank you, citizen to take this course. It's a 12-week course. Dan, a buddy of mine, Dan Coyne, who orchestrated this, the listening lunch, we both took that course, and what a great way to get to know the police. One of the things I wanted to point out about the police is that I didn't think about a police driving around while I'm sleeping to give me a good night of sleep. So I've been marinating on that for about 2 years. Since my class, that there's a cop that actually drives around while I'm sleeping, protecting me. So that's, you know, that's a different concept for citizens to think about. So I just wanted to give the other side of the police that they provide a great service for us, protecting, you know, and serving us. So with that said, and the reason I was asking about the police, because I know we haven't brought that up as a kind of an issue. And I know that, you know, another candidate brought that up. But I think our police do a fine job, for the most part.
For more than the most part. We have great officers.
We have great officers.
But the issue is that anyone in any profession, anyone's capable of good or bad, or making mistakes.
Sure.
And when our officers who have an immense power over someone's life, we need to make sure that those folks are held to the highest standard. You know, being arrested is not a fun experience. Going to jail, being handcuffed in the basement of the police station, is not fun. It is, and especially for young African-American males. We saw the Lawrence Crosby case where this young man is tackled, arrested, and he leaves the station with charges for stealing his own car, and, you know, in my case, petitioning to get on the ballot, to run for office, you know, being arrested for that. Imagine what's happening to young African-American males who aren't PhD students like Lawrence Crosby, who aren't candidates for office, and who don't have the political connections or the financial connections to make an issue and to fight against it. Both of us left the station with charges. And this can be detrimental to the life of a young African-American male. Not only the traumatic experience of being arrested and being criminalized, but now you have a criminal record, and that means it's harder for you to get a job. It's harder for you to, if you have to go to court, and even if you win, you take a day off of work. And we don't think about how that impacts someone who is low income, someone who's making minimum wage. When you take a day off of work to go to court, that means you're skipping a meal because you're losing a day's worth of salary. You're skipping some meals. You're not able to pay a phone bill. You're not able to pay rent or insurance. And so we have to really re-examine policing here in Evanston. I hope that Steve, and when I talked about transparency earlier, that goes into the police department as well, making sure that we have things like a citizens police review authority, to increase transparency, increase trust in the community. And once we increase that trust, we can also start tackling some of our more stubborn issues, such as gun violence here in the city. Because when folks don't trust our law enforcement, basic level, it is harder to solve a crime.
Divine, thank you so much for giving us a little bit of your story and helping us understand not only what you went through, but I think this helps. It helps, you know, with time for healing, because you're actually running for office. That's the great part. And I think a lot of young people out there, not only African-American, but Hispanic and other, can all relate and look up to you. So I saw you and Steve out at the march for the high school. Very relevant, and glad you were there. And I was watching you on Facebook, so we appreciate that. Steve, before he leaves, do you have anything to add? You don't have to, but just wanted to give you an opportunity.
You know, let me just we'll start backwards. We covered a lot of ground here. The other day at the rally, so this was the ETHS protest, and some of the students walked out, went to Fountain Square. They had asked Devon, they'd asked myself, Gary Gaspard, to come and just make a few remarks. And, you know, being, you know, 24 years old, a person of color, we have an incredibly diverse, you know, student body here at ETHS, and that crowd is incredibly diverse, right, that we're in front of, to have, you know, you up there talking to them, and only being really, you know, 6 years older than some of these kids, right? I think is incredibly inspiring. And even though I still consider myself young and youthful and all of that, I'm not 24 years old. And so hopefully I inspired them with a few words that I gave them and so forth. But there was something special about having you up there. I was pretty proud of it.
Well, Adrian mentioned that 55, people quote 55 as the prime of their life, so You're close to your prime.
I'm still way below my prime.
All right. On that note,
don't let that gray hair fool you.
Thank you, Devon, for coming up.
Introduce yourself.
I'm Megan.
Hi, Megan. It's Steve Hagerty.
Megan is not on the list. All right, Megan.
Hello, my name is Megan Heron. Nice to
Megan.
Be here.
Megan, pleasure to have you here.
Yes.
Another REBA person.
Yes, I am a REBA person.
All right, excellent. Well, tell us a little bit about your story.
My story is I came here in 2010 in Evanston, and I used to live in Rogers Park in 2008, and I live in a household where it's a good household, but it's not a usual household. We have 12 people living in my household. It's on Monroe Street, and it's part of Reba housing, and we have people age range of 34 to up to 85 years old, and we work together, we have meals together, and we eat lunch, supper, and all breakfast together. And some people that can't have breakfast with us go to work in the morning, but we try and have all our meals together. And we only have Sunday dinner, evening meal that we don't eat together, and Tuesday lunch we don't eat together. But we care for one another and we help each other out. We have 4 octogenarians in our house, and so we work with them and help them out when they need help and give them housing and make them feel accepted, and they do dishes for us, and they just make life good for us and keep us, yeah.
That's great, Megan. So Megan, it sounds like a lot of scheduling. So who's in charge of all this,
well,
coordinating all the schedules? Go ahead.
We have actually 3 household, it's a team in our household. We have 3 household leadership, David Hubke, who is the main coordinator in our household, Shar Oda and me, and we'll team, it's a team effort. Shar does, we meet once a week on Wednesdays for like half an hour and talk about our concerns we see in the household and concerns we see with people in our house. And Shar is the main person that does the chores, like setting the table and making sure dishwashing is done and things like that.
That sounds like a wonderful, wonderful community. Now, are outsiders allowed to come in, like me or Steve? Could we come and eat with you? Or?
Of course, we love people eating with us. We love people all the time.
Go ahead.
Well, anyone's welcome. We love with visitors and we eat together and visitors are great. Anyone can come in. Just give us like 24-hour advance or less. But
hospitable. Yeah. No, you are. You are.
We like to host people and we don't discriminate against anyone. We also help have a person who's in a wheelchair at our house, and there's three people, male caregivers, that help him throughout the day and night. And he's awesome. He's cool. He's very talented. He's very smart and like what's going on in the world today, and he cares about the Dakota Pipeline and other things like that. And like Civil War stuff, and he's smarter than me sometimes.
Well, no, that's great. And if you don't know, when I first came to Reba, actually back in the mid-90s, my wife and I was visiting and looking for a church, and we didn't know anything about household and the Reba community. So for the folks who are out there who don't really understand, there's a Reba Congregational Church, there's a Reba community that they started out in one house and about four or five people, and throughout about 50 years in Evanston, they started to not only acquire property, but it was all about community and community building. So anyone could come to Reba Community if you were in trouble, if you were looking for a home, if you were looking for help, if you were just looking for a friend, if you were looking for housing, they would help you. And this is one of the big secrets of Evanston, lovely secrets of Evanston about Reba that a lot of people don't understand. And Megan is actually part of a household. Well, they actually all live together. Everybody goes to work every day and everybody has jobs. But they actually build community within a house together. And they really care for each other. And it's a really wonderful place. So thank you, Megan, for sharing. Is there anything else you wanted to share that you covered everything, right?
I covered everything.
Okay.
Can I ask one question?
Yes.
Go for it.
So are there any services that you or your housemate wish the city provided, or any problems that you find just, you know, going about your day-to-day business and stuff with the city?
Good question.
I can help you with that, Megan.
I think I need help from wrapping.
Okay.
Sorry.
No worries. Well, I'll answer it this way. I just wish there was more people in the city who knew about Reba and knew the value of Reba. And also, on the other end, I think Reba needs to be a little more extroverted and bring themselves out to the community a little bit more. I think 30 or 40 years ago, it was different. We had different people that were in charge. For example, the Ninth Ward had Gene Feldman as an alderman. And he was a wonderful alderman who had a great relationship with Reba and also partnered with them on different housing issues. Made sure that Reba had a place to be who Reba was and is today. And I want to continue that relationship with whomever our mayor is, if that's Steve or anyone else, and just continue to partner and make this city a great place.
I agree. Thank you.
Thank you, Megan.
Welcome.
Thank you, Megan.
Yeah, pleasure to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
All right, Dan, how are we doing?
Good.
All right, next up is Helen Hudgens. Welcome to the listening lunch. All right, Helen is well known around Reba. She was the music director here for close to, I want to say, maybe 18 years or something like that.
Yeah, it was a long time.
It was a long time, over 18 years, maybe hit 20. But I had the pleasure of working with her for, I think, 12 or 14 in those years. And then Stackin' Baptist stole her from us. Yeah, I said it. I said it on Facebook Live. And prior to that, there was Jim Kroger, who was also sitting here. But Helen, tell us a little bit about your story. And you can start at Reba or wherever you want to start. But I'd love for everyone to hear about where you're from in South America.
Oh yeah, you want me to start there? Okay, so I was born and raised in Brazil. Came to Chicago to go to college as a young woman, and I've stayed here ever since. I've been in Evanston since 1992, and moved here to go to grad school at Northwestern, did a PhD up there in music. So I'm in academic music. I'm on faculty at North Park University, which is a small liberal arts college in the city. I've been there for 15 years. But my connection here to this neighborhood really was this church. So found this church right away when we moved to Evanston. And just want to echo maybe what's the hidden jewel that this place was. And it was a microcosm for me of some of the beautiful things about Evanston. And I also want to say that my new faith community, maybe just to highlight the contributions of faith communities and faith within the city, that I'm now at Second Baptist. A lot of things have gone into the story of why I'm there. While we were here at Reba, one of the big sort of movements within the church was to become a more welcoming church community to our whole neighborhood. This congregation was mostly white, our worship looked that way. And so there was a real discernment by the leadership to say if we want to be more welcoming to all of our neighbors from this diverse place here in the Ninth Ward, can we have a worship service which includes some of those elements? So I was a part of that, and so was Rob, and that was a great experiment in diversity within worship. I think we all learned a lot through that process. And it has led me to be now the minority person in a worship congregation, in service and in music, and I love that. So that's been my story.
So yeah, talk a bit about what that is like, the other side of the coin. Traditionally, Second Baptist, I think it's the, I want to say, the second oldest African-American
There's
church.
There's a little bit of an argument about that.
Oh, that
the
bad nature is that.
Get into the church historians.
There you go.
And, yeah, they would claim it, the oldest. It's been a wonderful experience, is all I can say. And has given me, I think, the gift of a little bit of a different perspective that I would have from my sort of middle-class white experience here, although I will say that even as a middle-class white person in Evanston, the issues of race and class, they were present all the way through. I experienced it through my kids. So I have two children. They both went through public schools. So Washington and King Lab, Pope John for my daughter, and then proud grads of ETHS. And then they both went to North Park University, free tuition maybe. That's the only way to do it. I use that faculty line.
Can I get in?
And this is their experience. They would have said that coming to North Park, they loved the diversity of our campus in the city. We are now, there is no majority demographic on our campus. And they were like fish in water in that department. And they what they noticed is how different it was for their peers, their white peers from the northern suburbs and from out of state, who had come from very homogenous communities. And that those, their fellow students really struggle a lot more with the conversation and with the issues that were on the campus. And whereas they were just like, yes, this is where it's at. They had been really well prepared by living in Evanston. So yay, ETHS for that, as well as, you know, we have, let me just jump on one of the issues here, which is the some of the inequities that happened. I kind of have a little bit more of a front row seat on that, being Second Baptist, actually. So as a white person walking into my choir rehearsal, you know, when there has been an incident in the city, we have to debrief that, you know, and then I start to hear all these other stories that come from other people's experiences, which are very different than just a real simple thing of how I get treated. I got pulled over by the Evanston police 2 weeks ago because I ran a red light, just kind of randomly. I was on my way to a choir rehearsal and I had stuff on my mind, no one around, I ran the light and police pulled me over. They were so, the officer was so, respectful and courteous right off the bat. Didn't have my insurance up to date. I mean, he could have nailed me. And he asked me, he said, where are you headed? And I said, I'm going to Second Baptist for a church choir rehearsal. And I probably had him, he said, what's wrong? My mind on music, I guess, I don't know. And he let me go. You know, without, he said, this is just a little warning, no worries, have a good church choir rehearsal. And when I share that in the choir, you know, it's like, how many of my colleagues there, you know, the gentleman in the tenor section who has story after story about getting pulled over for no reason by officers and really harassed. Or the woman who in the choir, the soprano in the choir, whose son was in the summertime, this is a 13-year-old, coming home to his home here in South Evanston, and she was in the backyard and heard the young man cry out, and came to around the front to see three squad cars and this young man flattened in his own front yard, you know, for possibly, you know, fifth profile of somebody. You know, those kind of stories I am privy to because I'm there at Second Baptist. But also just the community is vibrant and historic and remains a place where the experience of African Americans in this community is celebrated and known, and they are wanting to contribute. So that's the gift of being close to that community.
Yes, and they're not afraid to be politically active over there, would you
not
say?
Not at all. No, they would. Yeah, that was new to me to show up on a Sunday and have candidates for office in the front row. We didn't do that.
Wow. Well, Helen, thank you so much for your experience and for sharing today. Steve, I always give you an opportunity to comment, but if you don't have to.
No, thank you, Helen, for all those thoughtful remarks and insights. You know, the one insight I'd share as I was listening to that is, you know, I'm involved in the business community because I started a business, right, and all that, and I'm really involved in the nonprofit community because my wife and I have been very concerned, like a lot of people in Evanston, about the growing inequality in the world. It's bad. It's bad for the country. We think it's bad for communities. We think there's lots of organizations in Evanston that are trying to address that right here in our community, and how can we be involved with our time and our philanthropy in helping those. I think that, you know, the problems and the challenges that we have, and I often describe it as, you know, we're a work in progress. Like generations and generations of people just like us have come before us in this great town, and we're just building on that. one of the things, but these problems are complex, and one of the things that I think we can do is oftentimes we are in silos in this community. You know, there's the nonprofit sector, the business sector, the education, the city government, and so forth, and the faith community. And you made me think of it with the faith community. And all of these sectors know a lot about their specific thing, but I think we can get a lot out of, and I think I'm this person, somebody who is a real collaborator and a convener and can try to break down some of those silos.
Yes.
And form some connections and so forth where we can actually start to create and possibly do things in a new way that help us.
I hope that happens. That would be welcome.
And here's hoping that happens. Thank you, Helen. All right, next on the listening lunch, we're going to invite Jude Lilley down. All right, Jude grew up right here, right in Evanston, and he is back. He is back with a vengeance. He is ready to go. Jude, now you're a candidate for 202?
Yes, I am, first of all.
But before that, right.
Thank you all. I think this is reflective of what actually needs to be happening. It's an example of what ideally should happen across the city. So thank you again.
You're very welcome. Tell us a little bit about your story. I know you're homegrown and grew up here. And tell us what you're doing now.
Sure. Born and raised in Evanston. My parents were immigrants from the island of Haiti. So I'm first generation. There were five of us. Two were born in Haiti. Three of us were born here in the United States. My parents had limited education in Haiti. My father had a sixth grade education, and my mom a ninth grade education. And they came to this country for better opportunity. And one of the things that they knew and realized early on is that for their children to have a better quality of life than they did, they needed to push education, and that education would be a key. So they worked very, very hard and pushed us all through school, and we're all college educated, so I really thank them for all the sacrifices that they made. And then also the receptiveness of this community to welcome immigrants. I thought that was critical. We attended St. Mary's, so we're Catholic, and I really attribute that institution, that church, for serving as a venue for cultural exchange. We had a platform to be able to share our culture as well. So my mom led events like Taste of Haiti. St. Mary's, where people were able to come and sample our foods. So there were different events like that happened, which helped us to transition into the community.
Excellent. That sounds yummy, by the way.
It is. We have to try it sometimes. She's actually in town.
Wow. So, and you're back now.
Yes.
You're back. You're a guidance counselor in Chicago. Can you tell us a little bit about what you're doing now and how that is translating into kind of your run for the board for 202, and talk a little bit about that.
Yes, well, I'm back, and very, very happy to be back. We've been back, we were living in the south suburbs. We have four children, two of which attend Evanston Township High School. We have two in District 65 as well. And we came back to Evanston because I wanted them to experience what I did growing up. I have great memories of Evanston, and I feel that it really shaped me into the man that I am. So I wanted that for them. All of my professional life, I've been an educator in the inner city of Chicago, first on the south side, and now most recently, the past 10 years, on the west side of Chicago, as a high school counselor in the North Lawndale area. And I grew up with a sense of when much has been given to you, you must give back and pay it forward. So I always had it in my mind that when I returned to Evanston, that I would become engaged and not just sit on the sidelines. In order to challenge our community to be even greater than it already is, I think Evanston has served as an example across the nation on many fronts, especially as it relates to diversity. And now we're dealing with this question of equity, and we need to face it head on as a community, on all fronts: education, the business sector, not-for-profits, the religious institutions, and my decision to